visit this vineyard and perfect what your right hand has planted. May your hand be upon the Son of Man, whom you made strong for yourself. O Lord, O Lord, look down from heaven and see, and visit this vineyard and perfect what your right hand has planted. May your hand be upon the Son of Man, whom you made strong for yourself.
Through the prayers of the Theotokos, who save us, save us.
through the prayers of your most pure mother, O Christ our God, save us.
God grant you many years, God grant you many years, God grant you many blessings. O Son of God, risen from the dead, save us.
Apart. In his own flesh, He abolished the law with its commands and precepts to create in himself one new man from us who have been two, and to make peace, reconciling both of us to God in one body through his cross, which put that enmity to death. He came and announced the good news of peace to you who were far off and to those who were near. Through him, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. This means that you are strangers and aliens no longer. No, you are fellow citizens of the saints and members of the household of God. You form a building which rises on the fountain of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as a capstone. Through him, the whole structure is fitted together and takes shape as a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you are being built into this temple to become a dwelling place for God in the Spirit.
Peace be to you. Wisdom, be attentive.
Fear had seized them, so he got into the boat and went back across the lake. Faith Month, 125th anniversary. Well, I'm going to be careful. I did a 100th anniversary earlier this year, and I said, well, none of us were here 100 years ago, and I got corrected in the social hall. One of the parishioners is 101, and he still drives his wife to church every Sunday. So I'm not going to say none of us were here 125 years ago, because you just never know in our parish. And welcome to all of our distinguished guests, especially want to welcome a Lutheran pastor. Thank you so much for coming. And, you know, both of my parents were converts to Catholicism, as they say. And so I have just about every kind of Protestant in my background, except Lutheran. I think that's the one I don't have. A Presbyterian, Methodist, Church of England, maybe. What they call Congregational, which is who the Puritans are. The Puritans changed their name to the Congregationalists, but now they call it UCC, I think. And then Quakers. I'm very proud of my Quaker ancestry. They were abolitionists, and the family story is there were two twin brothers who were Quakers. And as you know, the Quakers were abolitionists, but they are not allowed to fight in the war. So after they started the Civil War, they were kind of like between a rock and a hard place. But they often took the most dangerous positions, which were the flag boy and the drummer boy, and there were two twin brothers in my family who were killed at the Battle of Vicksburg in the Civil War, trying to end slavery. So I'm very proud of my Quaker ancestors. And I was very proud 8 years ago when we elected our first black president. I felt like that was something that my Quaker ancestors, helped to bring about. Whether or not I liked him individually as a person or all of his policies, I was still very proud of that we elected a black president. And so I usually like to start right off with preaching, but sometimes in our churches, I just want to say how overwhelmed I am by how beautiful our church is when I walk into it. And walking in today, even the direction you're facing is a lot more spectacular than the direction I'm facing. Isn't it just beautiful here? Even before the clergy came out in all their beautiful blue vestments for the Mother of God. What a wonderful thing it is that God lets us worship in this beautiful church here in this lifetime. We don't have to wait till we're in heaven to experience all this. And it seems especially meaningful in our church because, a couple of years ago I went to Ukraine in the summer to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the re-legalization of our church. Imagine that. Only 25 years ago, it was against the law to belong to our church in Europe. It was part of Europe. It wasn't some savage third world country or the, unruly place. It was part of Europe, and it was against the law to belong to our church. And when I say it was against the law, I don't mean they gave you tickets like for speeding. As you all know, people were arrested, imprisoned, lost their jobs, were exiled into concentration camps, and were killed just for belonging to our church. And I remember a woman in my Portland parish from Ukraine saying when she was a little girl, she missed church one Sunday, and they backed a truck up to the church and loaded everybody into the truck, and no one ever found out what happened to them. No one ever heard of any of those people again. And she was only there because she missed church that Sunday. So we have to really get down on our knees and thank God that he's given us this wonderful country to live in where it's perfectly legal to pray as we please and to go to church where we please. And how many people don't seem to appreciate that anymore and they choose other things instead of worshiping God on a Sunday. But we're not going to judge them. We're going to thank God that he gave us this opportunity and that we should enjoy it. And praise God while we have the opportunity. Well, I don't think I talked about my staff yet at this church, did I? I don't want to repeat myself, but I haven't been here on a Sunday, have I, in Mahanoy City? Sometimes people wonder why the heck does the bishop have a staff with snakes on it? It looks kind of pagan, doesn't it? Looks like something out of Greek religion. And I used to think maybe it was. I mean, we Christians did borrow a lot of art from the pagans and give it a Christian meaning. But as a matter of fact, this is not pagan. This is right out of the Bible. If you go back and read the book of Numbers, the fourth book in the Bible, when the chosen people were wandering in the desert, it's called the Book of Numbers because there's a census at the beginning of the book and the end of the book. And it pretty much covers all the years in the desert, except the very first few weeks, I think, and then the very end before they go into the Promised Land. It's all in the Book of Numbers. And if you recall, there's quite a few incidents where the chosen people were complaining. Imagine that, people complaining. Especially people walking around in the desert. What would they have to complain about? But God had saved them from slavery in the land of Egypt, and they were out in the desert complaining. We don't like it here, we liked it better in Egypt, we liked the food better, we didn't have to drink water out of a rock, and all these things. And so they were complaining constantly, and I'm sure God's used to that. But they also were attacking Moses and his family, and God had had enough of it. And a couple of times it's very interesting to read how when God says to Moses, he says, I'm going to destroy them and get you another people. Moses talks him out of it. It's kind of funny because he appeals to God's reputation as if God cares about that. But Moses, of course, approaches him in a very human way, as we do. And Moses says, oh God, don't destroy them. You'll look bad if you do. So, he talks God out of destroying them. But on this one occasion where God is fed up with their complaining to teach them a lesson, he sends some snakes into the camp that start biting people. And these particular snakes are called seraph serpents in Hebrew. And that's one of the few words in Hebrew that's very easy for you to learn. So you can know a Hebrew word. It means flame or fire. And it's what the seraphim are named for. Because you know that word. The seraphim are those angels that are fiery angels, right? And these were called seraph serpents, evidently, because if they hit you, it burned like a fire. Well, it didn't just hurt, but it made people sick. And some people were even dying. So the people did, as we all do, after they started to face the consequences of their sins, they went to Moses and they said, tell God we're sorry. They were too embarrassed to go to God himself, so they went to Moses. They said, Moses, please tell God we're sorry and please take the snakes away. Notice how that was part of the deal. They didn't say, well, the snakes are probably good for us and will improve us. No, they said, please take the snakes away since we're sorry. So Moses went to God, and he told God, and God said to him something extremely strange. God said to Moses, make a serpent out of bronze and put it up on a stick and hold it up in the air, and anyone who looks at it will be cured of the snake bite. And Moses did that. He made a bronze serpent, put it on a pole. And some of the people were too sick already, but their families would drag them out of the tent and hold their heads up. And when they looked at the bronze serpent, they were cured of the snake bite. I said that's a very strange thing for God to tell Moses to do, because this is the same God who had just given them the Ten Commandments. And one of them said, you are not to make for yourself a graven image of anything in the skies or on the earth or under the earth. And certainly a serpent falls into one of those categories. So it's a very strange thing for God to say. But he did tell them, and as a matter of fact, this sign then cured them of their snake bite. It didn't stop them from complaining or ever sinning again, but I guess it taught them a lesson for a little while. Now this story is very dear to us Christians because Jesus quotes it in the Gospel of St. John in the 3rd chapter, when he says the Son of Man, referring to himself, he says, will be raised up like the serpent in the desert. And anyone who looks at him will have eternal life. And he's referring to the fact that he was going to be killed on a cross, and that's how he would pay for our sins, that he would be raised up like a serpent in the desert. So it's a very dear story to us Christians, but in particular, in our branch of the Christian faith, we use this as an example of how God did not really forbid all our work. And so it's one of the ways we even justify having all this art in our church, religious art, because God did say, look at this bronze serpent, and then when he took on flesh and it was possible for us to see him, that's why we're allowed to have religious art, or one of the reasons. And that's why Eastern bishops have these snakes on their staff because of that story from the book of Numbers. Although if you are bitten by a snake, I encourage you to go to the emergency room, because as you can see, this is not bronze, so it's not going to help you. Christ is our peace. Our reading from the Ephesians began with those words, and I always find those words so comforting. He is our peace. You know, it seems like it takes a great big burden off me every time I hear those words. You know, I mean, how do you find peace? There's a whole enormous section in the bookstore, isn't there? Psychology books and self-help books and family history books, and then another section of religion books, and then New Age religion books, and everybody's searching for something, you know? I love that line for the Sunday of Thomas where we sing, Thomas placed his restless hand into your life-giving side, O Lord. I always, when I hear that, I think, that's me, you know? He placed his restless hand into your life-giving side, O Lord. So how do you find peace? But when you hear that verse, it turns out you don't have to go find it. You know, you don't have to read all those books and do it yourself. It says Christ is our peace. St. Paul doesn't say, do this and you'll find peace. Think this way and you'll find peace. Believe this and you'll find peace. He says Christ is our peace. He already did something just by taking on our flesh that takes all the war and the fighting and the divisions in the world, and as we hear, and even the racism, all the prejudice, everything that makes us ill at ease, that we're not at peace, Christ already took care of that in his flesh. When the Son of God took on our flesh and walked among us, he already took care of that. So he says, he is our peace. The Epistle to the Ephesians is a very uplifting book. In fact, I understand the scholars in some sense have trouble making sense of it. They don't mean it's nonsense, but trying to fit it in with his other writings, because it doesn't seem to be addressed to any problems, really. It's not a problem-solving epistle, and they're not exactly sure why he wrote it. But it just presents the good news, really, the good news of Jesus Christ. And the whole first part of the epistle is really all about that, about telling you how blessed you are. All the treasures, you open up the treasure chest and look inside. And he begins by saying that you're adopted. Imagine what that's like. Maybe some of you know what that's like, but I don't. I have my birth parents, they're still alive. But to be alone someplace and then to be adopted. I remember one, I might start crying when I tell this, a tearjerker of a story. But a family out in my parish in Oregon adopted 11 children, mostly with handicaps. But the two of them were little girls from Yekaterinburg in Russia, in an orphanage in Russia. And they heard about this couple in Oregon who adopted these children. And somehow came through someplace the adoption agency, you know, but there were two sisters. And the older sister said, ask Mr. and Mrs. Barron to adopt my sister so at least she'll have a mommy and a dad. And they said, well, we couldn't do that. We'd have to adopt both of them. So they adopted both of the little girls. But that really kind of makes you think about what it's like, huh? Please adopt my little sister so at least she'll have a mommy. And so St. Paul says, you know, first of all, you all were adopted by God. However alone we might feel in life, that's a thing of the past when you realize you've been adopted because of the birth of Jesus. And then he goes on to say that we were redeemed. And redeemed is a word that doesn't mean too much in our society anymore. They used to redeem green stamps when I was a little kid. You took your green stamps, stamp store, and you got something, but that's not exactly what redemption meant. It's really more like in a pawn shop. If you go into a pawn shop and you get your own property back, or even worse, which is what we're really talking about in ancient times, is, you know, if you were taken as a slave or a prisoner of war or a hostage, and that does go on in the world nowadays, doesn't it? When somebody goes and pays the price to give you your freedom, that's what redemption is. And St. Paul says you were redeemed. And he says you are wise now and enlightened. And you do have wisdom, you know. When you see in the world there's something wrong, even though the rest of the world is telling you it's right and you know it's wrong, and nobody can change your mind, that's because you have some wisdom from God that doesn't come from the world. When you're the only person who's right, it's not the same as being hard-headed, you know. But it's when you know something is from God and everybody else is trying to lead you away from God. That's because you have wisdom from God, he says. And he lists all these treasures before he gets to where we read today, where he says these comforting words, he is our peace. Christ is our peace. And he goes on to talk about this peace a little bit more explicitly when he talks about the divisions among us. And in particular, the one that he's most concerned about here in his time is the division between the Jews, the chosen people, and the rest of us. And he says there was a wall of hostility between us, and Jesus broke down that wall. I'm always learning new things, and I just learned from a scripture scholar in our FRP. I didn't realize he was talking about a very specific wall. The temple at the time of Jesus and St. Paul had a Holy of Holies. And then it had a court where the chosen people were allowed to come in. And there was a big wall there. And on the other side, there were actually several walls, but I'm making it simple. There was a wall there that separated the Gentiles, the non-chosen people, from the chosen people. And you better not go through that door that separated them if you were not an Israelite. And he was saying that there was a big sign carved on the wall in stone. And it said, if you're not an Israelite and you go through this door, then your life is your own responsibility. In other words, you're going to be killed, but it's your responsibility, not our responsibility, if you're in the wrong court. And he was saying that we knew about this sign because of the historian Josephus, that he describes it in his history. But in 1967, in the Six-Day War, when the Jews occupied the Temple Mount, their archaeologists found that sign. It was still there, you know, in rubble because the temple was destroyed, but they found that sign that Josephus talked about. Isn't that interesting? That kind of historical confirmation for what we're reading about in our scriptures. And so St. Paul says that wall of hostility that separated the Jews from the Gentiles, that Jesus broke down that wall. So the promise isn't just for the chosen people anymore, but it's for us too. Well, it's interesting talking about the difference between the chosen people and the Gentiles, because that's very much what the story is today when we hear about one of Jesus' adventures here in the Gospel reading from St. Luke. I think it's an important story in his life because it's in three of the Gospels, almost the exact same story. And, you know, our youth retreat, our big youth rally in Ohio, the guest speaker, who was a Roman Catholic priest, gave the most colorful talk I've ever heard in my life on this story. But he asked if we ever read that one in our church. I know some of you are smiling because we read that one three times a year, don't we, on Sundays. Whoever put our readings together loves the reading about the pigs. And so do I. So do I. But to give it some setting here, I was talking about the difference between the chosen people and the Gentiles. It's kind of an important development in the life of Jesus here, because if you read it, for instance, in St. Matthew's Gospel, it's very clear. Jesus is, for the first time, crossing over into pagan territory, the kingdom of darkness. You know that? He's been with the chosen people there on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And it's very important, this kingdom of darkness, because at the beginning of his public life there, St. Matthew tells us when Jesus heard that John was arrested, he moved to Galilee to fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah, land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, people along the seashore and beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, a people living in darkness have seen a great light, and those in the shadow of death, light has dawned. And so St. Matthew tells us it's the fulfillment of the prophecy of Isaiah. And when Isaiah wrote that, the northern part of the Promised Land was the first part that had fallen to the kingdom of darkness, the pagans, in this case the Assyrian Empire. And they chipped away at the northern kingdom until they took the whole northern kingdom. But Zebulun and Naphtali were the most northern part, the first part to fall into the kingdom of darkness. And so Isaiah is talking about light going back up into the kingdom of darkness. And St. Matthew tells us that's why Jesus moved up there when he began his public life. But actually, he stayed in the Jewish cities up there so far, taught in the synagogues. And these are people who for 1,000 years or more have been receiving God's law. You might say he was cleaning them up. They knew to clean up their lives. All the immorality, the sin, the selfishness, the filth, the greed, the cruelty, the torture, all of those things have been gradually eradicated among the chosen people. If you read the Old Testament, you see how even when they executed someone, God had things to, so that he could separate them, so they didn't enjoy it like the pagans did. They didn't enjoy torturing people that they were killing. That God was gradually civilizing them, you know, cleaning them up with his law. But you cross the lake and they were pagans over there. We know that because there were pigs and the Jews didn't have pigs. So Jesus has crossed this lake and he's going into the pagan world, the kingdom of darkness. And it says as soon as he got off the boat, he was confronted by this man who was possessed by demons. So the whole force of the kingdom of evil is coming right at Jesus as soon as he gets off the boat. And it's such a sad story about this man. He's possessed by demons and he lives alone. And you can see all the different characteristics of evil here. This isolation. You know, isolation isn't always the same thing as being alone. Sometimes being alone is the only thing. But when we're isolating, it's when we're separating ourselves from everybody else, including God. And this man, his family, his society, kept trying to take care of him. And he kept insisting on leaving. He'd break the chain so he could go off and be isolated. And he lived in the cemetery because sin leads to death. And he refused to wear any clothes. And his body was all beaten up. He probably mutilated himself there in his rage. And he would cry out. They could hear him howling because he was unhappy. What a sad story. And when Jesus shows up, this man comes down immediately to meet Jesus. Because, to tell you the truth, the man inside there must have known who Jesus was, and he was looking for help. But the demons start yelling at Jesus. And when Jesus asks their name, he says, in another gospel, it's worded this way, he says, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And you know, a legion, it was a specific number of soldiers in the Roman army. It was a great big army of soldiers, was a legion. So he had an enormous number of demons inside of him. And they said, "What do you have to do with us, O Son of the Most High God? Have you come to torture us before your time, before our time?" And an interesting thing in the Gospels is the people don't know what to make of Jesus, but the demons all know who he is. And they call him Son of the Most High God. And it seems like they know they're going to go back to hell at some point, but they're asking him, "Let us stay out of hell for a little while longer. Can we go into those pigs over there?" And the pigs are kind of a symbol of impurity to the Jews, at least. I mean, we love pigs. They're tasty. But to the Jews, they're a symbol of evil and filth. And so Jesus gives them permission to go into the pigs. And immediately the pigs are all killed by the demons. Now, I want to mention to you what I think is a deep theological point about this. Did you ever wonder why this man can have a whole legion of demons in him, but as soon as they go into the pigs are all killed? tell you something deep. I think this is the reason. According to our revealed religion, God's greatest creation is you. You're made in the image and likeness of God. The angels are not. Not even Satan has the same dignity that you have. According to the scriptures, it never says the angels are made in the image and likeness of God, but you are. The least person on earth is made in the image and likeness of God. And I believe that's why he could withstand thousands of demons, because of his dignity in this world. It wasn't good for him. He wasn't happy. But that's why thousands of demons couldn't destroy him, because deep inside he was still a man. But these pigs, who were lower creatures, they couldn't, these demons killed them immediately. I have to tell you something, though. This priest I was saying, who preached on this in Ohio, he's a very good speaker. And as he did that, he did this whole herd of pigs going into the ocean, and he made all these snorting noises and squealing and everything for a long. It was amazing. It was like the sound effects from a Hollywood movie. They were all these stitches. And then I remember he asked this girl in the front row, "What would you do if you saw that?" She said, "I'd run away." And he said, "Now don't lie to me. I'm a priest. Tell me the truth. What would you do?" And she was frozen. He said, "You'd be taking selfies with the pigs, wouldn't you? And putting them on Facebook." And selfies with Jesus. And he was right. That is what people would do. And that's exactly what the shepherds did. It says the shepherds immediately ran away, not because they were afraid, but because they had to go tell everybody what they just saw. A man got out of a boat and cured the man that none of us could help. And plus he killed all the pigs. They weren't shepherds, really. They were swineherds. So they get there, and the people from the city come and say to Jesus, "We're not ready for you. Why don't you leave?" You know, a lot of people focus on that, about the people who told Jesus to leave. Well, this was the kingdom of darkness over here. They weren't ready. They hadn't been prepared for 1,000 years of God's law to receive the Messiah and God's presence. They weren't prepared. But you know, there's another way to look at that. Do you think Jesus knew in advance they weren't going to accept him over there? Of course he did. So you know what that means? He made that trip across the lake just to save that one possessed man. Isn't that right? Just to save that one man that everybody else had given up on, who was possessed by demons, who was naked and alone in the cemetery, and beat himself with rocks and howled and made noise. Jesus went across the lake just to save that one man over there. Glory to Jesus. Himself will ever be remembered, founders and benefactors of this holy church, and all you Christians of the true faith, always, now, and ever, and forever.
I expect the resurrection of the dead
liturgy, which we're pleased to accept from our hands, even though we stand before you thousands of archangels, tens of thousands of angels, cherubim and seraphim, six-winged, many-eyed, soaring aloft on their wings, singing, shouting, crying, loud, singing the triumphal hymn.
We pray.
God and Savior Jesus Christ be with all of you.
Is the love.
approach with fear of God and with faith.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The Lord is God and has revealed himself to us. Praise the name. We are.
Sanctify those who love the beauty of your house, and glorify them in return by your divine power, and do not forsake us who hope in you. Grant peace to your world, to your churches, to the priests, to our government, and to all your people. For all generous giving and every perfect gift is from a love coming down from you, the Father of lights. And we give glory, thanksgiving, and worship to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and ever and forever.
Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, right after the blessing, if you all would come up, and I will give you your medal, and that way if I don't get to say hello to you in the social hall, it'll be a chance to say hello, okay? So be sure to come up and get your medal from Pope Francis here. May Christ, our true God, risen from the dead, have mercy on us and save us. Through the prayers of His Most Holy Mother, through the prayers of all the Holy Apostles, through the prayers of St. John Chrysostom, Archbishop of Constantinople, through the prayers of St. Zenobius and Zenobia, through the prayers of all the saints, for He is gracious and He loves mankind.
Thank you.